Amen. You may be seated if you have your Bibles, if you would turn to Matthew chapter 5. We are going to continue looking at who you are. Do you know who you are? Last week we looked at the first couple verses in Matthew chapter 5, once we get past the Beatitudes, and Matthew writes that you are the salt of the earth. And we went through, how we're flavorful and how we penetrate and how our actions and our behavior makes a difference in not only our lives and the lives of believers, but living the Christian life the way that God wants us to live the Christian life changes the world. Because the power of the Holy Spirit lives inside of the hearts of every believer, and we're to be living out our faith every single day in every situation and in every circumstance. And when we do that, then the world sees Jesus as Jesus wants to be seen. The problem that we run into is that we oftentimes forget whose we are, that we belong to God through Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, and we don't always represent God well. But we can, because we are the salt of the earth. This morning, God is light, and in Him there is no darkness at all. God is light, and in Him there is no darkness at all. Jesus said this of Himself. He said, I am the light of the world. And Jesus, as He's teaching on the Sermon on the Mount, through the Sermon on the Mount, He says, followers of God, believers, Christians, Christ followers, you are the light of the world. So you are salt if you're a believer. You are light if you are a believer. And just as God is light and Christ is light, we are to be doers and beers of what light is. The light is not ours. It's the gift of God. It is by nature who we are in Christ, that we no longer are of ourselves and live for ourselves and do for ourselves, but we are the instruments that God has placed, the vessels that God has placed in this world, in today in Grand Junction, Colorado, to be His witnesses. And so when Jesus is teaching, He says this, you are the light of the world. Do you feel like the light of the world? Or do you feel like a lamp that's been turned off and just kind of, ruddy and just tired? Anybody tired this morning? Welcome to life. That's part of life. But Jesus says, you are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the instruction, the enlightenment that you give us through your word, Father, that we are not of ourselves. We are your light in this world of darkness. Father, may we live a light that shines on you, that we may speak of you and your sacrifice, of your provision, of your life, of your purpose, and of your ways. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We're going to look at four things this morning. Number one, we're going to kind of do what we did last week. I want to look at the characteristics of light. What is light? Well, light is pure. The light of Jesus Christ is pure, holy, righteous, glorious. It is without any blemish, without any taint. It is perfect. Ephesians, Paul writes in Ephesians 5, for you, usans, are not of darkness, that the day would overtake you like a thief, for you are all sons of light and sons of day. We are not of night nor of darkness. So he gives us an identity. So as light is pure, as it is clear, it helps us know who we are. So that when we look at each other, when we look at ourselves in the mirror, we don't see the age wrinkles and the spots and the lack of hair or the graying hair. For you that are blessed with hair, you don't actually, that's not what you should be seeing. Not that you don't want to look your best, and I get all that. But when you get down to the nuts and bolts of life and of who you are when you look in the mirror, you should be able to see Christ in you. Do you ever think about that? When you look in the mirror, do you ever say, God, thank you for who you've made me to be? God, thank you for saving me? God, thank you for putting life in me, for putting light in me, for making me salt, for making me understand and know that with every action, with every word, with every activity, you can use that to change someone's world, to change their eternal destiny. But it's not our light, it's the light that he has given us and the light that people see through him. Ephesians 5, 8, and 9 says, for you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of light consists in all goodness and righteousness and truth. The previous verse I gave you was 1 Thessalonians. I gave it to you out of order. Sorry. It happens. We are to walk in the light of God because it's pure. It's true. And it penetrates. Have you ever thought about this? Have you ever thought about how immense darkness is? When it's completely void of any light at all, how completely overwhelming and stifling darkness is that way. But all it takes is one strike of a match, one little light bulb, one cell phone that's even turned on or even put on the flashlight, and all of a sudden that light invades the darkness. Light invades darkness. By nature, light is more powerful than darkness. The light of God is more powerful than sin. Righteousness is stronger than and more complete than anything in the negative realm of life. That's how God designed it. When Jesus said he was the light of the world, can you think about that statement and what it truly entails? That Jesus, the Son of God, one of the Godhead, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, took on flesh and came down to the earth, to the world that we live in centuries ago. And he came and he lived a sinless, perfect life. In the midst of all the debauchery that was Israel and Rome through those days. And yet he remained pure, he remained truthful, he was God in the flesh. And because of what he did and how he lived his life and the choices that he made and the words that he spoke, he was faithful to the words of the Father in heaven. And when he died on that cross and he was put in the tomb, and when he arose from that tomb alive, having conquered death, having conquered darkness, having conquered evil, having conquered Satan, there was a change in the relation between God and his human creation. That Jesus, because of what he's done for us, God says, now in Christ, you can be the light of the world. I think that's awesome. You are light. When people see us, they should see light. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Light reveals everything. Have you ever been in a dark cave? You're fidgeting for your flashlight or your lantern or a match or something. The only time in your life you wished someone smoked a cigarette so they'd have something to strike so that you'd actually be able to see in front of you. And so you're in pitch darkness, and you know if you take a wrong turn, you can fall in a hole or you can run into what's worse than a brick wall, a stone wall. And you light that lighter, or you turn on that lamp or that lantern, and all of a sudden you can see on this side and on this side and in front of you. And if you turned around, you could see and behind you, and you'd be able to see the direction you came from and the direction you're going. but not only the direction you're going, but the directions you don't want to go. I don't want to run into a brick wall or a stone wall, and I don't want to fall into a 50-foot hole because I was ignorant. See, light opens the entire area of life to truth, and the light of God does that. We are the light of the world. And if God is light and in Him there is no darkness, then that means that we have the capacity within ourselves through what God is doing to emanate the light of God no matter where we find ourselves. See, because we don't get to spend 24 hours a day, 7 days a week in church, surrounded by believers, not most of us anyway. So we find ourselves in the darkness that is the world without Christ. Without hope. And so Jesus puts us and God puts us in the darkness of the world and says, you be my light. Don't be an idiot. Don't be a jerk. Don't be a legalist. Be my light. Shine my truth. Show them me. You know, a good place for all of us to start is remembering where we came from. You remember your life before you were a believer? Lanny was sharing yesterday his life before a believer. I didn't know Lanny before he was a Christian. I've known him since. I can't imagine him before he was a believer. The light of God got in him, just like it got in me and it got in so many of us. And it changed the very fabric and the foundation of who we are. We're God followers, children of God. We're God's kids if you're a Christian. He designed it that way. John 12:36 says, while you have the light, believe in the light. We're the light. Believe in the light of God so that you may become sons of light. These things Jesus spoke, and then he went away and he took some time by himself. You can read exactly what it says. He says, believe in the light. Believe in God, believe in Christ, and we have a direction, an illumination, a way to walk and a way to live life that we couldn't live when we were children of darkness. Does that make sense? So Jesus says, I'm going to give you a way to live that's not yours. I'm going to give you my pathway. I'm going to give you my direction. I'm going to give you my purpose, and that direction and that way and that purpose will become your way as you follow and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And as we trust and as we obey, then we become, can I say, brighter or lighter? See, here's the catch. If you've got a match and you've got a striker, and you walk around with that match, and you have forgotten to strike it, that match is useless, right? I got a match. Look what I got. And then you strike the match, and all of a sudden, it changes everything. That's what light does. That's what we're capable of through Christ. Have you ever been lost? I mean, truly, truly lost? I've shared this story before. Diana and I were hiking at Rattlesnake, trying to get to Rattlesnake Arch out in the desert. We thought we knew how to go. We thought we could read signs. We thought, you know, we could find a pathway. And we literally ended up completely lost. It's about 105 degrees. We were without water. We planned on a shorter hike. And we literally, 3:30, 4 o'clock, 4:30 in the afternoon, we've been without any water. We are exhausted. We've already hiked 12, 13 miles. And I'm lost. Diana's like, well, we're lost. And it's like, yeah, but I'm hurting. And she goes, well, I'm hurting too. And I said, yeah, but I'm hurting. And she said, well, I'm hurting too. And so we're like, okay, what do we do? Well, we figured it out. I had a Garmin, an old Garmin that had a track back button, and I hadn't figured out how to use it before. But I learned really quick. And I used what I had, and we found our path just as it was beginning to not cool off, because it doesn't cool off too much by 5 or 6 o'clock when it's 105 degrees. But we knew that the darkness was going to come, and we did not want to be lost in the dark. See, light guides us to where we need to go. God is light, and in Him, there is no darkness at all. So here's the truth. God will never lead you into darkness. Doesn't mean He won't place you in a situation where you have to be light, but He will never take you to the dark and leave you. He will never lead you to the dark so we can do dark things. He wants us to penetrate that darkness with our lives, with the truth. And that's what light does. It strips away darkness. It strips away untruth. Listen to what John writes in John chapter 3, verses 19 through 21. This is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, for their deeds were evil. For everyone who does evil hates the light and does not come to the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. But he who practices truth comes to the light, so that his deeds may be manifested as having been wrought in God. So light strips away that darkness. It strips away the evil. It strips away all the wrongness. And it shows things for what it really is. God is light. Jesus said He's light. He said, you are the light of the world. How lightful do you feel today? Is that a word, lightful? It is today. I'm coining it. No, but I'm going to copyright that, lightful. We should be lightful and delightful. That is a word. So that when people see us, they see Him. See, if they see our bad attitudes, if they see our grumpiness, if they see our uncertainty in the truths of life and the truth of God, then we're beginning to waver in the wrongness and the darkness, and we're children of light. And they need to see the truth. We need to be the truth. We need to know that the truth lives in us. And that's what light does. It strips away the darkness. And it also, man, it gets rid of that chaos. Like back to that cave without that light. Literally, you can be lost until you die. But once you light that match or turn on that lamp or that flashlight, all of a sudden, all of your fear, unless there's a rattlesnake or something really bad coming down or something like that, you begin to see as your eyes adjust to the light, and you begin to see, oh, well, I don't want to go here. I really don't want to go here. I certainly don't want to go here. So maybe I'll walk around the hole. Or maybe I'll turn around and go back, because that's the wise thing to do. But all of a sudden, all the doubts and the fears can be alleviated because of the light. That's what Christ does for us. That's what we can do for the world. Are you sure of your salvation? Do you know that Jesus Christ died for you? And He didn't just die for you, but that he went into a tomb. He was dead, and He rose from that tomb, rose from the grave. And with that supernatural victory that comes only from God, He changed everything for us. Do you believe that? That when you professed your faith, or if you've never professed your faith, that when you profess your faith in Christ, admit that you're a sinner, believe that Jesus is the only way to salvation, and put your faith and trust in Him, light comes to you. Do you believe that? Folks, we got to believe that. We've got to not only believe that, we've got to live that. Because if we're not living in such a way that points to Jesus as being our all in all, being everything, then the world looks at us and goes, I don't want what you have. I can doubt without being a Christian. I can be fearful without being a Christian. Why do I need God to be like you when you're just like me? See, we're light. That's by nature the character of a believer. That doesn't mean that we're not going to have fears. It doesn't mean that we're not going to have some doubts. But when we live in those fears and we live in those doubts and we live in that discord, then we're not living like we can. Because life can be hard. Amen? But this isn't it. We sang I'll Fly Away. I don't know if we'll fly away, but you know, if Jesus sounds that trumpet, we're going, man. Woo! This isn't it. This life is not the be-all to end-all. There is going to come a day when Jesus will return, or we will die and we will go and be with him in heaven. And life will truly begin for us. That's the promise. Listen to Ephesians 5, verses 11 through 14. Do not participate in the unfruitful deeds of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is disgraceful to even speak of the things which are done by them in secret. But all things become visible when they are exposed by the light. For everything that becomes visible is light. For this reason it says, awake, sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. You know, light gives us a warning. Don't go there. How many of you drive? How many of you have ever driven on an interstate? Okay, we live in Colorado, okay? Everybody drives on an interstate at some point. Okay, now there are flashing lights on the interstate. A lot of them. But there's special lights that they put out or they turn on when it gets slick or it's snowing and it's icy. And those lights are yellow-orange. I'm kind of colorblind, so I'm not sure exactly what they are, but I know they're flashing, and I know they're bright. And on a dark night, driving, let's say, through Glenwood Canyon, and I see two flashing lights that says slippery when wet, or ice may be present, slow down, guess what I'm supposed to do? Speed to 80 miles an hour and take that corner and slide right around that corner. Man, I'll be safe. I'm a Christian. I'll be saved. God won't let me die. Bologna. It's there to slow down. It's a warning that there's danger ahead. Now, if that sign would have been there that says slippery when wet, and you're driving by at 75 miles an hour and there's no light, there's no nothing, you're on your own. That's why they put lights on them, so that we'll see them as a warning to be careful because there's danger ahead. Light warns us of the dangers that are ahead of us. We're light, right? So what's the danger that we need to be purveying to our friends? That without Christ, light. But you can have Christ, because he wants you. And he loves you, and he died for you, and he wants a relationship with you. But without Christ, darkness is all you get. And then the end will come, but it won't be the end. That we all need Jesus as our Lord and Savior. But that doesn't mean we take this and go, boom, and try to give it to him hurtfully. Some people may need it. So, you know, that might be apropos. Go ahead and just... But you know, as a rule, we're to live like we're light. Have you ever known somebody that all they did was fret, were fearful? There was no positive in them. There was no hope in them. And all they did was worry about the next bad thing that might happen to them. Don't be like that. See, we have hope. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Paul writes that in Colossians. That in us, we have hope for eternity. And if we're light, and we're the light of the world that God has placed on this planet to emanate His light, then part of what we're to be emanating is that there's hope, even in the darkest of circumstances. That light changes everything. And that Jesus is the light. Light protects. Have you thought about that? Listen to Romans. Paul wrote this in Romans 13. The night is almost gone, and the day is near. Therefore, lay aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. We went through a series on the armor of God. And now we have another reference to what armor can do. It illuminates. It protects. He protects us. You know that? Nothing befalls any one of us that He doesn't allow. That He's not aware of. You know, if you ever thought that God was an old grandpa upstairs with a big beard and in a rocking chair going, oh my, I wish that wouldn't have happened. That's not a picture of God. He is the sovereign King of creation. Over all and above all, and nothing happens without His knowledge and His approval. I can't explain how all that works into theology. While darkness is here, and while sin is here, and while bad things happen to good people, that's a whole other sermon, a whole other conversation. But God is in control. And if you're in the deepest, darkest pit of your life, God still is in control of your life. And He loves you, and He wants you to know that He's trustworthy. And that in Him there's hope, and in Him there's peace, and in Him there is a way out. Trust and obey. Listen to what this text says again. I'm just going to read these three verses. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works. The place where we're going to shine, where we live, where we go. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works. So wherever we go, we are to be light. To be the light of God, the light of Christ. That everywhere we go, we are touching people with the reality and the truth of what it means to be a follower of God. But we have to be careful. That when they see our good works, they don't go, man, you're a good person. Man, you're so great. Man, you just love and care for everyone. Aren't you awesome? Yeah, thanks. Geez. I'm pretty good. Pat myself on. No, no, no. It's where we kind of have a problem, some people. That they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. So that everything we do, everything we say, everything we think, all the stuff that makes us, shines to Him. Pride goes before the fall, right? So we have to be careful that we don't fall into the pit that says, yeah, I'm great. I'm good. And aren't I awesome? No, we're not. We're blessed. And He's the one that blesses us. So the world needs to not go, Ray, you're an awesome guy. Whoa, 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 here's a plaque, here's a trophy, Ray. You're awesome. Gee, thanks, but it's really Him. I love it, and sometimes it seems very triteful. I don't know if that's a word either, but it is today. You get professional athletes that will catch a touchdown and they'll go to the end zone and they'll throw the football down and they'll get on their knee and, you know, they'll point. Tim Tebow was famous for that now. But a lot of pro athletes, and I just, as I see that, I have to get past my own orneriness and just take it for face value and say he's praising God. Whether he believes or not, everyone that's seeing him believes that he's praising someone else and praising the Father in heaven. See, that's what we get to do, is we get to glorify him and praise him with the entirety of our lives. And when we do that, people see him. And that's our purpose. Our purpose in life is to glorify God, to shine his light in the darkness that's coming from us because it's him. Because Christ is living his life through us. And we have purpose and we have hope and we have reason. So let your light shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify the Father who's in heaven. If we live life like this, God, it's all for you. Everything I do is going to be to glorify you. And what if we just took 24 hours? Took Monday from, let's just take 12 hours because most of us aren't up more than 12 to 18 hours. Let's take 18 hours. You get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and you say, God, today I'm going to give the entirety of my day to you. And so I'm going to begin with my feet hitting the floor before I even get my first cup of coffee, before I even put my slippers on and put my jacket on. God, I'm committing to you this morning that today is your day. I am going to live today making decisions that I know will honor you. Saying things in such a way that I know will honor you. Going to places and being around people with the sole purpose of honoring you. And if you open the door for me to speak, God, I will speak for you. But I'm committing at 6 o'clock this morning as I'm up that today is your day. And I'm going to live this day so that I intentionally do everything to glorify you. Have you ever done that? Try it sometimes. It really works. It changes your perspective. When you want to get snarky with the clerk at Walmart and you've made that pledge, God, I'm going to honor you today. You can't be snide and cutting and rude and mean. You know, if you're driving down and somebody's cutting out in front of you, you can't honk your horn and scream and shout, and even though you're the only one that hears, and certainly put your hands down. Because that's not glorifying to God. And if we intentionally did that for just one day, what difference do you think it would make in you? You think he would honor that? Just everybody just do this. Yes. Because he wants us to live life in such a way that he receives the glory for everything. And if we're honest, we're looking in that mirror over here, we don't always do that. I don't always do that. Ryan doesn't always do that. Dan doesn't. None of us do that. And if you think you do, you're wrong. Sorry. But try it. Don't try it. Commit to it. No, don't even commit to it. Submit to it. See, we can try, oh, well, I tried and failed. I did my best, God. It's not about us doing our best. It's about allowing God to live his life in us and through us. And when we submit to his authority and say, God, it's all about you, it will change the way we live our lives. It will. So here's my prayer for you this week. Number one, if you're not a believer, that you will trust Jesus as your Lord and Savior. That you will realize, and the only way you can realize this is if he is drawing you to himself. He's going, realize that you're a sinner. See, we can't just of our own accord go, oh, well, I want God. We might do it up here, but he does it here. And he draws us to himself. And if you feel that and you're feeling that this morning, it's like this. Lord, I'm a sinner. God, I don't understand all that that means, but I know I don't know you. You're not my God. You haven't saved me. God, I am a sinner because you say I'm a sinner. God, forgive me of my sin. I believe that Jesus is the way to God. I believe that he's the Messiah. And I put my faith and my trust. The best way I know how, God, I trust you to save me. That's where it begins. But that isn't where it ends. And it doesn't stop there for us. That's just the beginning. And all of a sudden, you're no longer darkness. You are now light. And all the things that fall into this Matthew passage are you. And so my prayer for us this week is that if you're not a believer, what I just said, but if you're a believer and you're a follower of God, that you would say, Lord, help me to be a light that people can see. Help me not to be glaring flashers or brights. Help me to be the light as perfect as you want me to be. And God, I submit to your direction. I submit to your authority. Live your life through me so that I bring glory and honor to you. That's what we get to do. And if you really, really, really want to see a difference, get up tomorrow at 6 o'clock in the morning before you put your sandals on and your slippers, before you get your coffee, say, God, today is yours. God, I'm going to honor you with my faithfulness this morning and this afternoon and tonight. Maybe I'll have to go to bed early because I'm worn out. But God, I'm going to be faithful to you today. Can you do that? Why don't you stand with me and let's go to the Lord in prayer. And here's the last thing you can do. As I'm praying, say, Lord, what would you have me to do today? God, help me to do that because I can't do it on my own. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we have heard this morning, Lord, that we are the salt of the earth and we are the light of the world. And that we are the light of the world because you are the light of the world and that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and that through him we find life. So God, I pray that we would submit ourselves to you, that we would be faithful in asking you those questions and being faithful and humbling ourselves and allowing you to lead and guide and direct us. Father, as we sing this hymn, Father, that we'd just be faithful, that we would trust you at every turn. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. I believe the sheet music is in the back of your bulletin or there's an insert. If not, the words are on the screen. Would you walk? Would you be faithful? And let's sing.